T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5. All three engines up and burning. 2, 1, 0, and...
Yeah. Lord, this for you. I was a mess, little hair on my chest, fresh as a newborn, but I'm headed for death. Some saying I'm blessed, cause I'm still alive. Every day in the hood, I was fighting to survive. So sin I acquired as an adolescent, walking in darkness, spirit facing oppression. You couldn't tell me nothing, swag was on 100, speeding in the fast lane, call me crash dummy. Then I put on the helmet of salvation and received the revelation. Yeah, I could be a leader in this nation, and gotta follow the code in the streets and be like the mother creep. See, I could be a leader in this nation.
Welcome to the Original Jeek Podcast. We are your hosts, rockinmrmagic and
UniqDNA.
And we are the Original Jeeks, y'all. Welcome to the pod. We're very excited for this one. We're going to talk about remakes. Remakes, baby. That's right. Everything's being remade nowadays. Everything in media keeps coming through. We keep on seeing stuff from the 80s, stuff from the 90s, stuff from the 2000s. It's crazy. So we're going to hit video games today. We're going to talk about music. We're going to talk about TV, film. So we're going to first kick it off with, for me, was near and dear to my heart, the video games. And starting off with one of the most iconic games in history, Final Fantasy VII.
Yeah.
Unique, tell me, man, how excited are you for this game, man?
Listen, man, I can't even. Let's just put it this way. When I was watching E3 and I saw that, I basically almost fell through the floor. I mean, yeah, like this is pretty much, you know, on my top list of video games. This Final Fantasy VII got to be like number -5. Like, it's just that high on the list. It's not. It's above one.
It's above one. Okay, I've heard high praise for FF7, baby. I've never heard above one. That's the first above one I've heard that. Wow. Final Fantasy VII is top 5 for me all the time. I can't put it above one. I can't do that. But it's like, I mean, to me, it solidified Sony with the PlayStation. I think that was the game that really just changed the game for them. Final Fantasy going from a Nintendo series to on the PlayStation and having that as an exclusive title just rocked gaming and really just put Sony's footprint down on the map as a console creator, man. I'm super hyped. I'm just as hyped as you. I'm even trying to think of where I was. I think it was in my living room, man. And I think I saw it on IGN on Facebook, and I think my wife was talking, and I don't know who she was talking to, one of the kids, I don't know. I saw the announcement, and then, because I wasn't able to watch, E3 stream, and I think I jumped out of my chair and, like, screamed like a girl, like, ah! Like, they're going to remake Final Fantasy, they're going to remake Final Fantasy. I was going wild, I was bugging out. Because, I personally have waited for this since Advent Children. Advent Children, to me, was such a tease on this is what this awesome game would be like if we put it to modern graphics. And you got to remember, like, it's almost been 10 years since Advent Children. So I'm really excited. I'm beyond hyped for this game. But my question for you, bro, what do you want to see? Like, do you want a complete shot-for-shot remake? Are you cool with some of these proposed changes to the battle system? You know, what do you want to see in this title?
I mean, when you think of remake, you automatically think it's going to be shot-for-shot. It's going to be the same thing you played 10 years ago, 20 years ago. But I just think with the advancement of technology and stuff, you got to get something different. You know, some of these kids don't even know what Final Fantasy VII is.
Oh, terrible. Amy Ray's
sad right. Thing. It's a very sad thing, but, you know, to go shot for shot, I mean, you know, that was the 90s, the early 2000s, so it might be a little boring for these kids, you know? So for it to be successful, I think they got to make some improvements. They got to make some changes. The story, of course, I would love to see the story stay the same. I thought it was an awesome story. That's what pulled me into the game in the first place. And so, you know, and like I said, that was one of my, you know, I mean, I was into gaming since Atari, but, you know, that really solidified gaming for me. You know, that was my first RPG, and I, ever since then, I've been in love with RPGs. Like, Final Fantasy did it for me. Yeah, man, like, for me, I want to see, definitely want to see the improved graphics. Like you said, like, to see something like Avid Children, probably better now, you know, because
right.
Technology's come so far. They have these, you know, these things really look like real people now, and, you know, especially what Sony showed off back in 2 years ago when the PS4 was announced.
They yes.
The skin technology and all that.
Oh, it's amazing.
Yeah, so I think it'd be awesome to see that, and then just to see, like, the summoning with the magic, man. Imagine that, you know? It's going to be like, I mean, it was crazy then with the cutscenes, but.
Yes, but I can't imagine the current summons are going to be really cool. And, you know, I thought, even though most people didn't seem to like it, I thought Final Fantasy 13 summons with the vehicles were really cool looking. I thought that design was really hot. And I could imagine just, you know, what the summons are going to look like in this game. It's going to be off the chain. It's going to be. So I think we're both agreed. And I think we just told everybody we going to buy it. Because that was going to be the next question. We definitely going to buy it.
If I could pre-order it right now, I would.
Okay. Now here's my only concern. I want to keep it real. My only concern with this game is not just to this game. It's a gaming across the board thing, and that's DLC.
We saw the Destiny fiasco.
Right. Exactly. So I'm just scared. I'm scared DLC could damage this classic, iconic game by withholding on us with DLC. I'm okay if you want to do some DLC that's purely extra, but just don't hold out on me with something that should be core to the game.
Right. Well, I mean, Square, you know, they stay pretty consistent with the DLC thing from what I can see with Final Fantasy 13 and you know, X-2 and all those. So, because it's in their hands, I trust that we're going to get a full game. If it was, you know, Bungie or one of these other guys.
Right, you know, yeah.
We've seen what we got from them before, so I'll be a little bit more nervous. But being that Square is still in control,
true.
You know, I'm not too worried about it. You know, they always seem to give us a full game. And I think because it is a remake, they got to give us a full game, man. We've already played it.
So, yes.
You know, it wouldn't be fair.
Yeah, it just wouldn't be right, especially because you're asking us to buy it again.
Right.
You know,
right.
They just dropped it on, I don't know if you saw, they just dropped it, I think last week, in the App Store.
Right. So now you can get it on iOS. I think it was.
Yeah, so, yeah. So you're asking us to not, we've already bought it, right. You know, and if you want to buy the original, it's going to cost you almost $100. And if you want to buy it for iOS, it's going to cost you like $16. And then you're going to want us to buy it again for another $60. But I'm not trying to pay $80 if I have to buy some DLC to get the full game. You know, but I have to say, you're right about Square's track record. They have done a phenomenal job compared to most developers when it comes to actually producing a full game. So you convinced me. I'm going to have more faith in our people at Square. Square Enix, if they're gonna actually drop a full game.
Yeah, I think we're pretty safe with it. That's my personal opinion. Nobody don't come looking for me if that's not what we get.
Y'all heard that, people. Don't come looking for UniqDNA if this doesn't work out. We have no connections that we know of at Square, and don't come looking for us. We wish we could. You ain't lying. Speaking of developers, let's change from publishers from Square to Capcom, and Resident Evil 2.
Yeah, this is another one I was excited for, man. You know, I've been a big Resident Evil guy. I never finished Resident Evil 2 the first time, but that's probably because I was mid-teens, and I was scared out of my mind already.
I was about to say, wait, I was about to say, hold on, hold on. You've never finished RE2.
Nah, man, because, you know, when did that come out? I was probably about 13, I think.
Well, maybe see, I was 16 when RE2 came out. When RE2 came out, I was 16. And this is terrible. And anybody that I work with at Camp Dry Gulch or, Pastor George, if you have ever hear this podcast, I'm sorry. But I'm working for Camp Dry Gulch, and one of the full-time people there had his PlayStation. He bought RE2, and a bunch of us that were counselors and other people that worked there, we would go to his room, or we would set up a TV in one of the bunkhouses, not where the kids are there. Anyone listen? The kids were not around. No kids around. The kids didn't see none of this. And we would watch my man Will play Resident Evil 2. And it was just like, none of us got to play. We just had to watch. But it was so scary. I remember the scary, almost scariest moment when the first liquor jumps down from the ceiling and the tongue is out. And we're like, ah!
I think I ran out the room, man.
Yo, it was a bug out. And we had all the lights off, of course, and we're watching him play this game. We're like, yo, don't go for the head. Get that shotgun. Use the shotgun. It was crazy. And I ended up, when I got home after working there all summer, one of the first things I did is I went out. I bought myself an N64 with GoldenEye and Resident Evil 2. So I could finally play it myself. And I played it, and I loved it. Like, I loved the story. I love the characters. I like Leon. Like, I love Leon. I can't stand Chris Redfield. Give me Leon Kennedy any day, any RE. That's my man's. I love Leon Kennedy. So I am so hyped. And what really has me super excited is when the GameCube released the first Resident Evil reboot, it was fantastic. And then I heard they were going to release Resident Evil 2 on the GameCube. And this was early 2000s. So, because I was still working for, EB Games before the GameStop buyout. And I was like, cool, they're going to put RE2 on this? I can't wait. So that dropped. I bought it. I go home. I pop the disc in my GameCube. And it's just a port. And I was so heated. Like, I just dropped $40 on a port. Are you kidding me? But I didn't do my homework. That's on me. I didn't do my homework.
You know, sometimes the ports are cool. You know, like, I remember when they ported a couple of games from PS1 to PS2, and they were pretty dope. You know, even though I basically bought the same game over, and the graphics wasn't any better. It's just that nostalgia of playing it again. You know.
Yeah, it's a good game. It's a good game. I figure with that, but for me, I'm very, I don't know, I guess you'd call it a purist. I am all about, when I want to go nostalgia, that's when I pull out my NES, or I pull out my 64, or my PS1, or whatnot, and I go full out nostalgia. Like, I'm just not a big port dude. I understand ports for the fact of just getting a new audience. I think that's fine. I think it works. I was just upset because, you know, early 2000s, you know, there was no Facebook, there was no MySpace, there was no Twitter, there was not even IGN was there, but it was nowhere near the massive site it is now as far as reporting video game news. Right. So unless you were an insider, I was as close to being a fan insider working for EB, as you could pretty much get, I was the only one who was expecting a complete remake. When RE2 dropped for GameCube, so I was sorely disappointed. So when I heard this news, I was almost excited that I was for Final Fantasy VII, because I'm not a horror guy, but Resident Evil just, there's something about it that just stuck with me. I've never been a big zombie dude, never been a horror dude, but RE2 pulled me completely into the series. Resident Evil 1 was good,
and I liked it, but it just didn't completely click for me. So when 2 came out and I watched it and I played it, that was it. I was over. I was full in. I bought Nemesis after that, and I bought Code Veronica, and I bought, you know, Code Veronica X on the PS2 because I had the Dreamcast joint and the PlayStation, and I bought RE4 and 5 and all. And, you know, I even bought, I forget, the whole the first person shooter one, which was terrible. I mean, I was full in. I've been full in since then. So for them to do this, to probably resurrect what's starting to be a dying fan base from what I can see, I think this is just a genius move by Capcom to put this out there and remake RE2.
I don't think it's dying per se. I think it's a huge generational gap between us and you know, now you got like games like Dying Light, which is awesome, you know. Don't get me wrong. I mean, I've been playing it nonstop since I got it.
Yeah.
But it's just a different type of zombie game, you know? And then, right. You know, the popularity of zombies is just insane.
Oh, it's anyway. Insane.
Which, you know, I'm on board too, man. You know, I got the zombies run app on my phone and I go running too. And I got, you know, I watch Walking Dead and now I'm started with this new one, Fear the Walking Dead. And, you know, I'm a zombie guy too. So, you know. I'm not saying it's a bad thing, but it's definitely, like I said, it's a generational gap between the original zombies as we know them and stuff we're seeing nowadays. So,
that's a whole other conversation, man. Because I have to admit, I'm probably the one cat in America that didn't watch the Fear the Walking Dead premiere, and that's only because I was at my boy's house and I came home and I had to help my wife get ready. Because she went on a mini vacation with our kids, so I ended up crashing because I knew I had to get up and go to work, and I missed it. Thankfully, no one has spoiled it for me, you know. So I am gonna watch it, but my thing on that, that's a whole. We'll go back. We'll revisit that on TV, but. So we've got 2 confirmed awesome remakes that both of us are hyped about.
Yeah,
and we both obviously are in. We're both buying these joints. So
if I remember correctly, wasn't it Resident Evil 2 multiplayer?
No. Well, it was not. I think the first multiplayer was 5.
It was 5?
I think so. Because 0, you can jump between the characters, but it wasn't multiplayer. I think 5 was the first multiplayer.
That's what I'm interested to see, you know, now with the involvement of online, you know, multiplayer. I just want to see where they're going to go with it now. You know what I mean? It's a different generation, man. I mean, I remember having a little box, that huge box hooked up to my PS2. Back in the PS2.
The network adapter. I remember the network. You know how I wanted that network adapter so bad. I was working for EB. I was broke. I had like no money, and I bought the network adapter the day it came out. I had $40 in my bank account. I had an employee discount, and I spent pretty much all I had left, except for like $2, to get that joint because I had SOCOM waiting for me at home, and I wanted to be one of the first cats to play online. Yeah, SOCOM. You remember that? SOCOM, yo, people, see, all these cats talk about Call of Duty, people forget about SOCOM. SOCOM was the truth.
SOCOM was the original.
Yes.
And GoldenEye.
Yes. Game. So SOCOM was the truth for these war games. I mean, there was the one that changed the whole game with the online playing and everything. That was it for me. So we've got these two solid remakes. Well, let's jump into some rumors here. Final Fantasy VII Remake director Tetsuya expressed a desire to do Final Fantasy V and VI.
That could be interesting.
Yeah.
It could be interesting. I mean, I jumped on at Final Fantasy VII, so I don't have much experience with V and VI. A few of my friends are like diehard more than me Final Fantasy fans. They played them all. Like, I got one friend, he plays through the entire series from 1 to 13 every year.
What? What? Yeah. Who has time for that?
Exactly.
Yo, who has time to do that?
You know, he's a diehard fan, so.
Okay, yeah,
I can't knock him.
I'm a diehard fan, bro.
He's excited for that.
Although, look, I'm a diehard fan too, but and I have them. I'm not gonna front. I've got them all, but to play 1 through 13 in a year.
He's a dedicated guy, man. What can I say?
Is he independently wealthy?
Nah. Not that I know of, anyway.
Like, who
works a regular, you know, job, 9 to 5, 8 hours a day, whatever.
Okay.
You know, you just take it one day. I guess over the years, man, you know where to go, what to do. You know, after playing it so much, you pretty much got it memorized.
But
so,
still.
I'm sure that cuts down on the playing time, but.
I mean, unless this cat is doing some crazy speed runs, I'm like, RPGs are hard to speed run through, especially with random battles. Like, you can only...
when you start getting into 7 and 8.
Yeah! You can only go through it so fast. Yeah. That's dedication right there. Wow.
Yeah, man.
Okay. That, I ain't got no reactions for that. I don't even know.
Yeah, when he told me, I didn't really, I was just speechless.
He's clearly single. He must be single.
Yeah.
Okay. That's okay. I get it now. Okay. All right. What about, because we can talk about Final Fantasy all day. And honestly, we're probably going to do a Final Fantasy episode dedicated to the greatness of Final Fantasy.
Of course.
But
Final Fantasy and Fallout, man. I mean, I'm just, you know, I can talk about that all day.
Okay. Well, let's talk about Shenmue. And we both know Shenmue 3 had that amazing Kickstarter, which I am sad to say I did not get my chance to be a part of. Did you?
100 million or something like that.
Oh, I mean, they set the record. They got the 2 million in a couple of hours.
I think it was like 30 minutes. They hit like 2 million.
It is absolutely. And what's so insane is for years people said, there's no way they'd be able to raise that. They wouldn't be able to get the money. And they got the money like that.
I mean, I had no doubt because I was a shit. I mean, I had I had the Dreamcast. May it rest in peace. But,
no.
Yeah, I was a big Shenmue fan. Like I said, RPGs was my thing for a long time, and so I was a big Shenmue fan. And if I had the money at the time, I would have been one of those guys within the 30 minutes. But you know, you get older, you gotta make smart money choices.
I had the same. My predicament was almost the same. My predicament was this. My money too, because my gracious wife, if you're listening, honey, I love you. My gracious wife bought me for Father's Day the PS4 Batman Collector's Edition.
Yeah, which I saw that and I'm still so jealous. You know.
So I'm pretty much gifted out for a while, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, any extra spending of money on me is kind of cut. But I see this Kickstarter and I'm like, you know what? I've made a little extra money if I could probably do this. But my problem was I wanted a physical copy. I'm big into physical copies. I am not a big fan of direct download. Maybe I'm just paranoid, but I'm a big physical copy guy. So yeah. When I saw that they weren't giving physical copies for the PS4, that was a turnoff for me. And until like 10 days left, then they started offering physical copies for the PS4. But by that time, you know, cash flow, that extra money is gone now.
Right.
So I couldn't get mine now. And I think about it, I missed the opportunity. But what did I really miss? I missed the opportunity to give away $60 for a backers only edition of the game that I still have to wait 2 years for.
Right.
You know, it's still coming out December 2017, so I don't feel that bad anymore. And my $60 wasn't going to put them over to, you know, another level, you know, of how deep they're going to go in the game. But they're going to go really deep. I think they raised. I know they raised over $6 million.
Oh yeah.
And the different levels of how far they're going to go into developing the game is just fantastic. I was hoping they hit the $10 million, to be honest, because the whole plan they had was just fantastic. They really thought this out before they kicked it. I have to touch this, even though it's off topic, going backwards a bit. Well, you said something earlier when we were talking about Resident Evil that just resonated with me when you talked about multiplayer in Resident Evil. So if anybody from Capcom is listening to this, we like a royalty, all right?
I'll take 2%.
Yeah, we'll take a measly combined 5%, y'all.
There you go.
Measly combined 5%. So, RE, you start from the beginning, Resident Evil Online. You start from the mansion, all right? And you can have a max of, and this would also be great to control sessions. So you have a max of, let's say, 20 people per session, all right? And what you do is you pick a character and you play through the mansion, but everyone starts at a different point. So let's say you're Chris, and I start the game as Jill, and so-and-so starts the game as Wesker, and so-and-so starts the game as Barry. And
just bring all of them back.
Bring them all back. And then you play as one, and part of it is you can kind of get a tease of playing through their storyline, but obviously you can't play through it all because most of them die. But but you play through them as that person, and you have goals as far as, you know, you've got to find certain things, you've got to figure certain things out, you've got to escape the mansion, obviously, and, you know, so you kind of steal some Grand Theft Auto 5 parts as far as accomplishing goals and getting out, and right. and maybe even some working together, because you can talk to each other through the headsets, and obviously they're cops, they've got their own headset things going on, so they can work together to, you know, to escape the mansion and, you know, expose whatever from Umbrella. And what would be cool is if you've got larger sessions, would be to have an adversary mode where you've got people working as Umbrella agents and they're working against the STARS crew as they're trying to go through the mansion and they're tripping you up and then you see them, you'll firefight type thing. I think that would be really hot. And that's something I would play online extensively. Like, my wife would never see me extensively. You know, so it's just a thought, you know. If Capcom, if you dig it, hit us up, you know. We would love to talk.
Address on the line.
Yeah, for real. We would love to talk concept. We'd love to talk.
On Twitter, UniqDNA.
That's
Instagram,
right.
You can find me.
Yeah, you can find us. We out there, baby. We out there. At rockinmrmagic, baby. We out there. So, I just thought, obviously you have to be fleshed out, but that to me, that poofed in my head when you said online with Resident Evil. I was like, yo, that would be dope.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I always, and then it, you know, that was one of the things that I always loved about, you know, now that I remember it, it was Resident Evil 5, the multiplayer, because it's just like, you get to share in the horror with somebody else. So you get to laugh at them screaming like a little girl.
Right.
And someone jumps out and grabs their leg.
They go, ah, get off me, get it off me, get it off me. Exactly. And some things like, and especially when you have things that you'd have to work with somebody on.
Yeah.
You know, Grand Theft Auto's done a good job with the rally races. You know, where one person's driving, the other person's got to do the directions. You know, you may have a thing where your teammate gets grabbed by a couple of zombies and you've got 30 seconds to pop them off before they die. Like, you know, collaborative stuff. There's so much that could happen there.
But, I mean, even if they do it, you know, like Dying Light is a good example.
Yes.
They got to jump in, jump out kind of thing.
Yes, yes.
Which is cool. Or you can play it solo. It's up to you. I like that, too. Same kind of concept as you jump in and they might be in a totally different part of the world and you know you guys kind of find each other, but it's that, you know, certain times you need help, it's cool to have that option to be like, you know what, let me go online and somebody jump in or me and Magic jump in together and we get this knocked out and you know, maybe knock out a few quests that I'll be having trouble with, and it eliminates that discouragement, because I'll tell you one thing, Resident Evil was a hard game.
Yes.
It was a hard game. You died about 30 times before you even got past the first stage.
Right.
depending on how good you were. But, you know, that definitely helped. You know, because I, like I said, part of why I didn't finish Resident Evil 2 was it was hard. And I was scared out of my mind because I was 13.
With these remakes, we've got movies. Movies have really just gone off on the remake kick. Some good, I guess. And as recent news, everyone talked about the flop that is the Fantastic Four. Now, before I let you get into it, I'm going to preface my comments with this. I thought the Jessica Alba, Chris Evans version, and Michael Chiklis version was bad. I didn't think it could get worse. Sadly, I was mistaken.
Very much so. Very much so. I thought that one was bad, but I thought it gave us what we wanted at the time.
Okay.
I mean, they were venturing, at that time, they were venturing into new territory. Comic book movies weren't a big thing yet. You know, with the exception of Spider-Man,
who just
won't die. I mean, don't get me wrong.
It's Spider-Man.
But, you know, it's just like, come on, man. But how many times are you going to remake it? It's like Batman. But, yeah, you know, I mean, you look back, it's like, what do you have to compare it to at that time for comic book movies? You know, at that time, I think it was pretty successful, unless you were a diehard comic book fan, you know?
Right.
If you were, you know, you were just casually into Marvel and, you know, DC Comics or the cartoons,
mm-hmm.
I didn't think it was too bad. I didn't think it was terrible for that. You know, for that audience.
Okay.
If you're a diehard fan, it's really hard to please the diehard fans. You guys are terrible.
I mean, wow. Are you taking shots at me, man? Already taking shots.
I mean, I'm not just you. I'm a diehard fan too. But I take it for what it is. I know it's Hollywood and they gotta make money too. So you know, a lot of times, I put my fandom to the side. For the sake of them making, you know, bringing my imagination to life, to reality. So,
yeah. Oh, I've tried that. I can only do that to a certain level. If the actors are good, then they can get away with more. Case in point for me is Thor. I enjoy Thor thoroughly, and partially because Chris Hemsworth did a very good job, and no one else in Hollywood looks closer to Thor than that dude. And Tom and Hiddleston, oh my god, he was amazing as Loki. Like, I mean, to me, he stole the show. And partially with Avengers, he stole the show. So if you've got great actors in your film, and the supporting cast was very good as well, then you can get away with being lax in the storyline and the origin story and stuff. I said lax, not freewheeling it, because there are some movies like X-Men, which if I had not been on a date, I would have walked out of the theater because I was so irritated with, pardon me, everything that they did, everything they changed. Like, Iceman was a kid. That flipped me out. I was like, yeah. Come on. I was like, no. You know, Angel wasn't even in the movie. Beast wasn't in the movie. I'm like, you know what? Way to diss the original X-Men. Like, if you're not going to have them in the movie because you want the more popular ones in, fine. Don't make them kids. At least have, like, a Hall of Fame where you can walk by and see the uniforms and be like, yeah, these were the original cast.
Excited, but, you know, yeah, at least showing a little teaser, at least.
Yeah, and keep some continuity, you know? I think the worst one, and I didn't see it in the theater, so I didn't waste any money on it. I just wasted time. Was First Class. I can't believe I actually watched that entire thing. and they had Havoc on this First Class. I'm like, you're having Cyclops' brother before him, and you don't mention the family tie at all or anything? Like, are you kidding me? Like, I got comic book movies.
Tie it into the original, to the first X-Men movie, it doesn't make sense because
no.
Professor X went to get Cyclops from his parents.
Yes.
And his brother was there.
Yes.
And it was like they didn't even know each other.
Right. Like it makes no sense. Yeah, so some of these movies, these reboots are killing me, man. Like I thought Fantastic Four was doomed by the casting. When they announced the cast, I already thought it was doomed. And it's not, everyone wants to say it's a race thing. It's not a race thing for me. It's not completely a race thing. For me, it's a, does this even make any sense thing? Like, if you want to, of course, I love Michael B. Jordan. I loved him in The Wire. I loved him in Friday Night Lights. I'm going to love him in Creed because I think the trailers for that look fantastic. Which I'm glad is more like Rocky 16, whatever. But, you know, I think he's going to be amazing in that. I like Michael B. Jordan tremendously. I didn't understand why he was cast as Human Torch. He's got the swag for it. He's got the confidence. But to me, if you're going to make him, you know, and Kate Mara siblings, especially because she's, like, it just doesn't make any sense. Like, not that it doesn't happen, but it's very rare that a black family adopts a white kid. Just doesn't happen that much. Again, hopefully it'll happen more because people need to be adopted, but it's odd. And then Sue is the older sibling. So generally, something as odd as a black family adopting a white kid is, it would probably be in the reverse where either they already had a kid, they couldn't have more, and they adopted. Because that was just really weird for me. That and the fact that if I didn't know who the casting was, like I watched the trailer with my son and asked him what he thought. He figured that Michael B. Jordan was going to be playing the Thing, and the dude playing baseball who was playing Ben Grimm was the Human Torch. And again, because we know that Sue Storm and Johnny Storm are their brother and sister. You know, it's just, I didn't like the cast. I forget the kid's name who played Mr. Fantastic. I like him, but he's not old enough. People forget that.
He's like 12.
Yeah, the dude looks like he's 12. Like, again, being a comic book purist, you know, the Storm parents weren't all that giddy about a college-age Sue falling in love with, you know, with Reed because Reed was like 30. You know, they weren't down with that big age gap to begin with. And he's 12. Like, he didn't look old enough. They put glasses on him to make him look older. Reed Richards doesn't wear glasses. I thought they were really lazy. They got talented actors, don't get me wrong. I thought they were just lazy with the casting as far as, hey, let's put up some fresh, young faces in Hollywood, and we're going to make these guys a Fantastic Four. Like, I thought from there, I was like, okay, this movie is doomed. And then they actually, and pun intended, the movie was actually doomed. it just bugged me out. But I've heard, I don't know how much of D3 you caught, but three movies that Disney is going to be remaking have me a bit concerned. And I'm going to start with my favorite of the three, in Pete's Dragon. Now, Pete's Dragon, I don't know if you've seen it. It's a 70s live-action film where the dragon is the only animated part of the movie. And the kid, Pete's the only one who can see his dragon. It's one of my favorite Disney films. You know, being an 80s kid, I have an affinity for Disney's darker time and a lot of the films that don't get the hype in Disney lore that others do. Race to Witch Mountain before they remade it, which was a good remake, mind you. Condor Man and, just so many silly movies that they did in the 70s. That I actually have a strong affinity for. But Peace Dragon was always just a really special movie to me. I don't know why. And I just have this bad feeling that they might screw this one up. And then I'm hearing the Jungle Book is also being remade, and I haven't confirmed this because I just, to be honest, as if I haven't had time to do the research, so feel free to comment. But I'm hearing the Jungle Book remake is going to be live action.
Well, and remember, they did live action back in
The 90s with Jason Lee. Yes.
Yeah.
And that was a hot mess. It was a hot mess. No one was expecting 30-year-old Mowgli.
Yeah, that was weird.
It was a hot mess.
None of the animals talked either.
He said, "Hey, Baloo," and Bagheera was there for a hot second, and then the whole thing with King Louie and making fire. Monkey sounds again.
It was weird.
It was very weird. No. And then the last one, and this one has, to me, the most potential to be a complete, I don't even know, is Dumbo being directed by Tim Burton. What do you say to that? Like,
I don't know, man.
Don't get me wrong. I like Tim Burton.
I love Tim Burton.
I mean, come on. 1989 Batman with Michael Keaton and Batman Returns. Nightmare Before Christmas. Mars Attacks. I mean, Tim Burton has done some stuff that I've thoroughly, thoroughly enjoyed. But it's all... Dumbo has had some parts that were dark. You know, making fun of him, some bad dreams, stuff like that. But all in all, it's a pretty light movie. I've never seen Tim Burton direct anything. And maybe I don't know enough. Maybe there's something out there that he's done that I don't know about. But this to me seems to be a very odd coupling.
Did he direct Pee Wee Herman?
Pee Wee Herman's Big Adventure? Yeah! That was weird. Come on, I love Pee Wee Herman's Big Adventure.
With the exception of the bike, it wasn't that dark. It's pretty lighthearted.
Okay, well, I mean, Pee Wee's Big Adventure, it's pretty lighthearted. I mean, I love it. And, people tell me I'm crazy. My wife hates Pee Wee, and my kids love Pee Wee because I had them watch Pee Wee's Playhouse, and they've seen the movie. I love it. It was very weird. There's a couple dark spots. I mean, you have...
I remember when they were chopping up the bike.
Yeah, they had the dream. They're chopping up the bike with the evil clowns, and, the dinosaur comes out of nowhere and eats it. And then you had Large Marge. You can't forget about Large Marge.
Yeah.
That was freaking scary.
Yeah.
That was wild. So you had a couple spots that were really out there. And because the whole overall movie is weird, because Pee Wee's weird, it fit Burton. And honestly, if they do it and it's mostly light, like Pee Wee's mostly light, probably 70% light, I can see that as something that would work.
I see it being, this is, my personal, I see it being a Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, Alice in Wonderland, Johnny Depp, sort of Dumbo.
Oh, God, no. Oh.
Because those two, Tim Burton directed those two, too.
Oh, I didn't even want to think about those.
That's what I see. I see it just being really weird and out there and just kind of strange.
But does that mean Johnny Depp's going to be in it? Because I'm sorry. I'm sick of seeing Johnny Depp in everything Tim Burton does. I'm really sick. Johnny Depp's a talented dude. But please, there's somebody else. Like, that my brain hurts just thinking about that. I'm sorry. I know like five people that like the Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, and less that like the Alice in Wonderland. And maybe that's just because my circle's pretty freaking big. So no, I don't know many people that actually like those movies.
Believe it. I'm a huge Alice in Wonderland fan. That is my all-time favorite book. And so pretty much anything to do with Alice in Wonderland, I probably like it.
Okay. Everybody, okay. I give the avant-garde to that movie and doing something different. I give the props for that. Because I didn't want And I knew Tim wasn't going to obviously copy the cartoon, and I didn't expect him to.
I think he stuck really close to the story material, which was good. It was really weird. But Alice in Wonderland as a book is just really weird anyway.
Well, that brings me to my point. Because some stuff that's already weird, Tim likes to push it to extreme weird. Just sometimes just leave the weirdness alone. Just let the weirdness be what it is and just display that instead of having to always put your specific brand of weird on top of it. Like,
but then he wouldn't be him. I mean, you know. It's like asking Steven Spielberg or what's his name? I can't think of it right now. To not be as accurate as possible and as detailed as possible in everything that they do.
No. I'm disagreeing with you on that one. Yes, because you know what? Steven Spielberg, I know you'll never listen to this, but I hope someone tags you and has listened to this. Steven Spielberg, please stop putting lights on every alien vessel. We don't know if alien vessels have lights. We don't know that. But every vessel you put shines bright lights. We don't know that. I would like to see Steven Spielberg do one dark, lightless alien vessel. You can't keep...
You can't think about alien spaceships without lights.
Yes, I can.
Space is dark and you need lights.
Do you know what? The best spaceship out... And you don't know this probably because you're not a Star Trek guy. But to me...
Oh, we're not going to talk about that.
To me, my favorite ship outside of the Enterprise is the Borg Collective Cube. Because everyone has these aerodynamic lights, spaceships, and they've got... And why? It's space. Nothing needs to be aerodynamic. You don't need a whole bunch of lights. You just need a big, massive cube to carry all your people in. That's it. Like, all this aerodynamic stuff, and we're going to have lights aiming in this direction. You've got so many stars providing light, you don't need no lights.
It wouldn't appeal to the masses.
The masses need to start using their brains and realize there's no aerodynamicness needed in space.
Then they couldn't relate to it being a spaceship. It has to be a spaceship. It has to look like a plane. It has to have lights.
And all aliens apparently have to have, like, I'm so scared for this Dumbo movie because I'm so scared that Tim's gonna fully impress his specific brand of weird into this movie. And
but, I mean, let's be real. Dumbo is a pretty weird movie. I haven't watched it in a while.
It's an elephant who flies with big ears. Of course, it's weird. It's physically and aerodynamically impossible. Yeah, it's weird. And he does this talking mouse comes out of nowhere.
The whole sideshow in the circus. I mean, it's pretty weird. And it's pretty dark, too, if you think about it from an adult perspective. As, you know, a child watching it, it's pretty dark.
Well, it's a bullying movie. It's a bully about being bullied.
Disney always does dark stuff in a lighthearted way.
You know? Oh, yeah. I mean,
every character in Disney is orphaned. Or will be orphaned by the end of the movie.
Okay, well, we all know that Disney takes movies or stories that were very dark and lightened them up a lot. You know, obviously Alice in Wonderland, obviously Snow White, The Little Mermaid. You know, so many of these classic stories that people love in film and animation, I should say specifically, were all doctored to be significantly lighter than the real story was. But I look at Dumbo and... If Johnny Depp's going to be in it, that's going to grate me wrong. But I'm just trying to figure out what can you do with this? Like, how much of a variation can you spin? Can you really put on Dumbo? And I have this feeling that's going to be it's going to become a Tim Burton's anti-bullying PSA. And that's just is this going to be odd? Like, I don't want that. I don't want that for Burton. I don't want that for Disney. Like, if you're going to remake it. I mean, I want it to be a remake that honestly is gonna that's gonna be a success.
I honestly don't want to see a remake at all.
Me personally, neither. I mean, the Jungle Book, they should scratch that.
Disney movies alone.
Yeah, the Jungle Book should be scratched, man. You've tried it. You tried it, it's done. Be done with it. Dumbo, like, if a movie was made in the 30s, man, let it go. Or the 40s or 50s, let it go. You know, like some things you can remake because they're old but not too old. But some of this stuff, and if you're going to, if you're Disney and you're going to remake, I thought the best recent Disney remake was the aforementioned Race to Witch Mountain. That was, honestly, I like it better than the original, and I rarely, rarely ever say that. That was a fantastic job of taking a cult Disney film that wasn't praised or acclaimed as this nationally known great, you must see this film, and made it better. If they want to go into the 70s vaults and take some of those less acclaimed films or even the 60s and 50s and remake those, I'm all for it. I mean, a complete big green light from me. If they want to take, and that's even with Pete's Dragon, you know, I'm a little scared they'll mess it up. They could take Condor Man. They could take the, and they did a great job with The Absent-Minded Professor with Robin Williams and Flubber. That was a great remake. They could do a bit better with remaking The Love Bug because I thought Lindsay Lohan does wrong choice.
That was
terrible. And I thought the Paratrap remake was also terrible. But again, I don't like Lindsay Lohan. Lindsay, sorry. I don't like you as an actress. Haley Mills killed it the first time. You just really can't beat that.
The Parent Trap was pretty good. I was younger than you were, so that could be part of it too.
Well, because I saw the original first, then I saw the new one, and the original was homier. It had more whole. It was sweeter.
I think it adapted well to the times.
You want to also ruin the Parent Trap remake for me was that the Olsen twins did their own similar movie
at the same time. Yeah.
And that kind of overdid it for me.
Yeah, that kind of messed it up.
Yeah.
Because I remember my sisters watching it, and I'm like, wait, isn't this the same movie?
Yes, it was exactly. It was the same thing. It just changed a couple things different. It was the exact same thing. You know, but I would love it if they go back and they do that. Take, you know, Darby O'Gill and the Little People. Just go back into that era and remake Old Yeller. Remake Old Yeller.
Leave alone, man.
Old Yeller can use a remake.
I don't think so.
The Swiss Family Robinson could use a remake.
No.
Yes.
No.
Because I want to see what they do with a new house, man. That could use a remake. I honestly think that could use... Treasure Island could use a remake.
Nah, I think the classics need to stay the classics, and that's why they're classics.
Some of those are classics, but they're not big-time classics. If it's not a big-time classic, I say it's fair game.
Swiss Family Robinson is a huge big-time classic.
Okay, well, scratch Swiss Family Robinson. Put 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea on that joint, then. That I would love to see, and I love that movie. I am really big on that movie.
But I would just like to see that
because of the Nautilus.
Technology.
Yeah, you want to see a new Nautilus. You know, that's the draw. The draw is seeing a new Nautilus, you know, modernized for today's audience on what you could do with a stealth submarine. That would be hot, you know.
Yeah.
Some of these things, like the classics, like you said, I'm agreeing with you. The classics, leave them alone. Just take your stuff that didn't do so great and then remake those. That I think they're safe with, and they've proven to do a good job with those. They've made a lot of money with Flubber. They made a lot of money with Escape to Witch Mountain, and why they haven't followed up with the sequel, because there was a sequel in the 70s, why they haven't done another one, maybe The Rock's too busy, I'm sorry, but they should have done another one already. Like, I don't even know why they haven't. That's just silly. They left money on the table not remaking that. Not remaking the sequel.
I think maybe. Well, yeah. Part of it probably is because he's too busy. Every time I turn around, he's in a movie. But
yeah, I mean, and then Ballers on top of it now. You know, that is Dwayne. You know, Dwayne's everywhere, and I give him props. You know, he has truly made the transition. He's a movie star now. Movie star first, then wrestler, and I applaud that Dwayne Johnson.
Yeah.
More power to you. Well, let's get off of film for a second. Let's talk television.
Well, before we go there,
okay.
The subject still of movies and sequels and Tim Burton.
Okay.
What do you think about Beetlejuice 2?
Oh, I was hoping you were going to say that. Because honestly, I am so torn right now on Beetlejuice 2. I'm at the point where it's been so long, I want them to leave it alone. Part of me really wants to see it. Another part of me says, it's been a long time.
It's been a long time.
And
Michael Keaton hasn't changed that much.
Well,
as far as looks, anyway.
Yeah, I mean, I think a Beetlejuice reboot would be more successful than than a sequel, just because it's been so long. Like, I don't know. I'm very torn. I have to admit, I'm just really, really torn over Beetlejuice 2. I can't decide right, how I feel about it. It's civil war going on right now. Yeah, part of me is yes, part of me is no. It's tough. It's really tough for me because Beetlejuice is one of those, one of those roles that Michael Keaton did to me, where he was just on fire. In the 80s, early 90s, where between Beetlejuice and Batman, Mr. Mom, Multiplicity, the Dream Team, like, he was on fire. And everything he touched was good. I don't know. I just, part of me, the strongest part of me feels it's just been a little too long for that sequel. That sequel would have been greenlit in the early 2000s and came out before 2010, I'd say, okay, cool. But I don't know. We have a whole generation of moviegoers who have no idea about Beetlejuice unless their parents did a good job raising them and showed the movie to them.
That's true. That's true. But in my mind, it's definitely a classic. So, I don't know. The kid in me wants to see part two. The kid in me always wanted to see a part two.
Well, same here.
When I was a kid, you know.
Yeah, same here. The kid in me always wanted to see a part two.
There has to be another part.
Well, it's odd because I seem to see a trend with films where if the parent loved it, they're probably not going to redo it. But if it's something that grandparents are telling kids, oh, you should have seen this movie, there seem to be more of those that are being done. It just seems to be a trend. Like, and this is actually a great transition to TV. Inspector Gadget released on Netflix remake. And I'm going to be honest, I told myself I was going to watch it before we recorded. I could bring myself to do it. Because I don't want to ruin Inspector Gadget for me. Inspector Gadget to me is one of those shows that just, you can't touch. It was extremely iconic, being voiced by, the great Don Adams, God rest his soul. From, a.k.a. Maxwell Smart from Get Smart. When a guy has that type of voice, and his voice is so tied to Folly, and you have a show that ran, I think it ran for 6 seasons, that was just, you heard that music, and it was just like, it just reverberated, man. I love that show so much. I just can't bring myself to watch a new version. It's just, I can't do it. I don't know how, because you're a couple years younger, I don't know how, how much Inspector Gadget you got to see of the run. Like,
but, I've seen it all.
I don't know if you heard about the Netflix is also going to do a Danger Mouse remake. Now that one, I understand why they're doing it, because a lot of American kids didn't watch Danger Mouse. Because it was a BBC program, and it was a short. We're talking about generally the average runtime, I think, for it was about 10 minutes. And American kids really would see it on Nickelodeon. And it was bundled in, I think, I'm trying to remember what show they bundled it in with, to be honest. But they bundled that in with a spinoff of it. Again, it was BBC produced, Count Duckula. But it wasn't a big hit here in the States. So being that it has a cult following and mainly European following, I can understand why they take a risk with that show, because most people are going to be like, hey, what's this, Danger Mouse? Oh, it's a spy mouse. Okay, kind of cool, you know, James Bond type thing. We'll check it out without having to worry about relying on, you know, the past. But I'm a huge Danger Mouse fan. Because I say Danger Mouse to someone in the street, they're thinking about, you know, Danger Mouse. They're thinking about Gnarls Barkley. They're thinking about DJ Danger Mouse. They're not thinking about a cartoon. I'm cool with them taking that. I don't know how much I'm going to like it. I'm not holding my breath on greatness, but I'm totally cool with that being remade. But Inspector Gadget, man.
Gadget for me. It's one of those you gotta leave it alone. I mean, the movie was horrible.
Oh, don't even. Oh God, I was. Matthew. That's one of those ones I want to slap Matthew Broderick for. Like, no,
yeah.
No.
Yeah, I love Matthew Broderick as an actor, but the movie was terrible.
Yeah, Disney. We slap you, Disney.
Yeah.
Slap, you're slapping you for that one too.
Yeah.
Y'all screwed that up.
I don't know. This series. I mean, from what I understand, it's CGI, right? It's not even. Animation.
Yeah, that's what I understand
that already
too.
That kills it for me. I'm not crazy. There's only a few movies that I love in CGI, and that's movies. I'm not crazy about CGI TV series. Like, as much as I love Star Wars, it's hard even for me to watch, you know, the Clone Wars because it's all CGI. And it's just kind of weird. You know, a lot of times I find myself, when I am watching it, it's just I'm listening more than watching. The voices are, you know, the voice acting is great. But, I don't know. I think I'm going to give it a try for just, you know.
Just to see if they do it justice?
Yeah. I mean, it's one of my all-time favorites as a kid, and why not? You know, on a boring Tuesday night or whatever, Wednesday night.
What are we going to do? I don't know. Let's watch Inspector Gadget.
Yeah.
I'm not
excited about it. I feel like if I want to watch Inspector Gadget, I'll just go whip out the DVD.
Box. Yes, that's it.
I mean,
oh, I have a system that I'm employing here in my house, and that's for me. It's the kid test, and because I am so old school, I have so many of, you know, the classic series. Like, I have Danger Mouse the collection. I have Underdog the collection. I've got, you know, Inspector Gadget.
That movie was terrible too.
Yes, Disney, slap again. Y'all screwed that up. Why use
Peabody? What are they doing over there, man?
Well, you can't blame Disney for that one. That was DreamWorks, but still.
Yeah, but still.
And they screwed DreamWorks up. That Rocky and Bullwinkle movie was straight up terrible. That was horrible.
Get me started on that. They ruined my childhood forever.
Yes. I don't know. Some of these really pain me to you know, to look at and consider, you know, them remaking. Like, it's like, you know, like, it's like if they decide. Now, some things I could understand the consideration. Like, okay, G.I. Joe, classic. I can understand wanting to do a new G.I. Joe because war has changed, weapons have changed, and any kid that watches G.I. Joe now, it's going to, yes, most of it was against Cobra Commando, but there was always the overlying Russian, you know, Cold War part there that kids today don't understand because they don't understand, they don't even know about the Cold War. So, I can understand a new G.I. Joe. I can see that.
I'm going to see it, but
I wouldn't want it.
It pains me to think that.
Yeah, it pains me to think about it.
Kids thinking of G.I. Joe now is Channing Tatum.
Oh, but you know what? That first movie was horrid. I did like the second one though. The one with The Rock and Bruce Willis, and where Channing Tatum dies. Sorry, Channing Tatum, nothing personal, bro. You died. I loved that one.
I'm kind of glad
he did. Yeah, me too. I didn't like him as Duke. I didn't see him as Duke. That's just that I thought he was poorly cast as Duke, and I don't think that's his fault.
Obviously there's some scripting issues there. Casting issues, but I just like G.I. Joe is G.I. Joe, man. And they dumped him down into like this goofy playboy kind of I'm going yeah. to war kind of guy instead of like, yo, this is Joe.
Yes.
This is Duke.
Yes.
This is, he's supposed to be, you know, the man.
Yeah, exactly.
Not like whatever that was.
Yeah, but I thought the second one was good. Because it
was better.
Yeah, it felt a lot more like G.I. Joe. I mean, Snake Eyes was off the chain, yeah. You know. I thought the second one was phenomenally better. But there's going off to cartoons because we've talked a whole lot about cartoons. Have you heard that Will Smith and Overbrook Entertainment are proposing a fresh Prince of Bel-Air reboot?
Don't do it. Kill yourself.
Whoa! Shots fired! Woo! Oh, I'm right there with you. I do not want to see. Well, it's not been long enough. I mean, to me, if it's not been long enough to remake the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air,
I think it has been long enough. I mean, it's been what?
I don't think it's been long enough.
10 years.
You know why it's not been long enough? It's not been long enough because it's still on TV. You can still go to TV Land and watch it. It's not been long enough. It's not like it's a black and white show or an 80s show that you haven't seen in a hot minute and it's lingering in your head, but it's not in front of you. If you want to remake something, I don't know. And it's tough because, okay, if we're staying with black comedy, because that's what Fresh Prince of Bel-Air is, if you're going to remake something, remake 227. Remake Good Times. Or remake What's Happening.
I don't think you can, man.
You can remake Good Times. You can remake Good Times.
You think so?
Yes. What's Happening? Probably not. But you could remake Good Times. You could do that. You could do a new Good Times. I could see that.
The thing is that I think only our age and above will watch it. And I think that's where the challenge is. Like you said, Fresh Prince is old enough that it's been about, what, 10, 15 years, somewhere around there.
Man, it's been like 20 almost, bro.
Yeah.
It's almost 20.
It's been about 20 years.
Almost 20 years.
The younger generation, they were probably 4 or 5.
No, man. I mean, 96 was like the next to last. I think 96 was season 5.
Right, so, I mean...
And my daughter was born in 96, man. Like,
okay.
You know, so, and she's 19. Saying,
they're young enough that they remember it?
Well, they remember it because I've been watching it on DVD.
No, because even, like, you know... Like,
or on TV Land.
My sister's 19.
Okay.
20. And she remembers it, partly because it's still on television.
Right.
But also partly because, you know, we used to watch it along with Family Matters and all, you know, all those shows that used to come on.
Yes.
On Channel 11. On WPIX.
WPIX.
When it was still PIX, Pix 11 with the frog.
Yeah. WB, baby. We're obviously showing our location. You know, we're East Coast people here. For anyone listening on the West Coast, Midwest, you know, I'm still a Midwest boy, but I'm first sure I'm stuck here in the East Coast.
I think you still, if you bring back like a, I mean, it's going to be like, remember when they tried to do Fat Albert?
The movie?
Yeah.
I liked the movie. It wasn't great.
It wasn't. That's what I'm saying.
But I liked it.
I don't think it was as like successful as they thought it was going to be because the only ones that really watched it were the ones that can remember it.
You know what? I went and saw that in the theater, and there was a lot of people brought their kids, man.
I don't think the excitement was there for the kids as much as it was for the...
Oh, no, the excitement. You're right. The excitement was all on us. Oh yeah, we were the ones excited. Or if the kids were excited for it, then that's because they were brought up with it. My kids wanted to see it because my wife had bought me the Fat Albert collection for my birthday.
Exactly.
So they had watched it. So my little kids, if it came out again today, my little ones would be excited for it because they've seen it and they like it.
Exactly, but I mean, you look at kids that's, you know, 19, 20, even 16. Or younger, they don't remember that, you know.
So, they don't. Well, it's tough because you know we're talking about
the only reference even to Fat Albert right now would be the movie with
with Keenan.
Keenan and Raven Simone and you know that cast, but they don't even remember that it was a cartoon.
Yeah.
They don't.
So.
And I don't know. Because that was probably, that was during, you know, that was, you know, a 70s show, 70s into the 80s. But I mean, that was, you know, from a time where, like Good Times and What's Happening, that I think, you know, still has enough, it's still close enough, but it's not too far off where it could work. And remember, it was a movie, and it had never been on the big screen before. We were used to a show. The problem is, like, I wouldn't touch Fat Albert just because no one's allowed to hang out in junkyards no more. Like, most kids can't connect to that because you can't just go hang out in the junkyard. You know, there's tons of places you can't just go and hang out at anymore. You know, it's not like you could back in the 70s or 80s where you could go to a vacant lot and not get thrown out. You know?
I'm saying, I think that a lot of these older movies, like in, you know, 70s, 60s, unless you just totally rewrite them and just call it the same name, it doesn't resonate because these kids don't understand, like, you know?
Oh, okay. Yeah, you're right. Because you know what? And I'm going to make you feel old right now, and I already feel old with it. But I noticed this the other day, man. These young kids are going to have no idea why we say hang up the phone.
Exactly.
They're going to be like, what are you talking about, hang up the phone? You don't hang the phone. You press end.
Exactly.
They have no concept of that. Like,
or even rewind.
Or rewind. Or please be, if you say please be kind, rewind. Like, they no idea. No concept. So, like, you're definitely right, because there's certain things that don't translate that you have to, you know, that you have to replace. Okay, so, all right, so let's talk about successful remakes. We're going to talk about TV, movies, and game. And I'm going to start with movie. And this is a perfect segue here, because I have a tie when it comes to my movie. These are two films, both from the 60s, that were, one was remade in the 90s, and one was remade in the early 2000s. I'm talking about Ocean's 11.
Gotta love it.
Which... Full of great actors. Some of them I don't even like, but full of great actors that did a phenomenal job, and I thought did a better job than the original. I was not a big fan of the original, and I love the Rat Pack, but they weren't the actors of the George Clooney, Brad Pitt, Bernie Mac, you know, Don Cheadle. They're not the actors of that level. And the chemistry was amazing. Amazing chemistry. And my second one is a bit of a surprise, and a lot of our listeners probably don't even know about this film, but it stars my man Harrison Ford, who is one of my favorite all-time actors, Greg Kinnear and Julia Ormond with Richard Crenna in Sabrina. Sabrina, if you don't know yourself, was originally Humphrey Bogart and Audrey Hepburn, and they remade Sabrina in the 90s. And again, it's one of these ones that I love the remake better than the original. And
I think I like the original more. Not that I didn't like the remake. I like the remake.
I think I like
the cast of the original more, I think.
Oh, so see, it's tough because you've got Bogart and Hepburn. But right. For me, but for me,
toss up, really.
See, if I'm throwing out an ace card, if I've got actors, if I have four aces in my deck, and I'm dropping an ace, Harrison Ford is one of my aces. You know, Robert De Niro, Al Pacino, Harrison Ford, and probably, I don't know, either Robert Duvall or Gene Hackman. I'm throwing in there another ace. Like, you throw one of those four dudes in the film, that film's probably going to be box office. It's going to be really good. Like, there's a very small handful of bad movies that those guys have done. And Harrison Ford just did an amazing job in that film. Julia Ormond, she was amazing to me. And I loved how the 90s version, how they really made her look like she was significantly younger. And then just the transition It was hard. I mean, obviously they had 30 years up in makeup and technology compared to the 60s version, but I really thought that they did a great job in capturing the tension as they're vying for her attention and her affection. And probably it's probably just a timing thing, obviously, because I didn't come up in the 60s, but I thought that the humor was just done a lot better than the original. And also, I don't know how much you like piano music, but the soundtrack to the remake of Sabrina is fantastic. Like, it's one of my favorite soundtracks, movie soundtracks, period. If I need a night where I need some quiet and I just want to chill, I will turn on that movie or I'll turn on the soundtrack and I'll just listen to the beautiful piano music for that film that they did. And to me, just the whole thing combined between the acting, the humor, there was a lot more humor in that version than the original, and the music was amazing. And that puts, again, Sabrina the original was a fantastic film, but that remake to me was just phenomenal.
Yeah, I'm not, like I said, I liked it. I didn't say it was bad. I just, for whatever reason, I love the cast of the original.
Oh, you can't beat the cast of the original. I mean, Greg Kinnear is a great guy, but you can't. I don't think he would put himself in that type of realm as far that range when it comes to the acting chops of that original cast. I mean, that is, I can't deny you that. Well, your side, give me a film. Give me a remake that you think, from a film wise, was extremely successful.
There's so many remakes these days. of course, I love Ocean. I love all the Ocean series. Ocean 11, of course, is one of my all-time favorites. Obviously, it was seriously successful. I'm trying to think of one that you haven't mentioned already. Going to 60 Seconds was a good one.
I don't know about that.
I don't know. I thought it was a pretty good remake. I don't know if it was better than the original.
I'm biased. I'm so anti Nicolas Cage. and that's like, anything after Face Off, I'm so like anti Nicolas Cage. Anything before Face Off, Raising Arizona, was great. Guarding Tess was hilarious. He's done good films, and Face Off was phenomenal. I'm just, anything post Face Off for me with Nicolas Cage, I shouldn't say that, but I mean, I just Snake Eyes, good. 8mm, fantastic. He's done a lot of great films, but post 90s, I thought Gone 60 Seconds was really weak. I thought the cars were amazing. The cars were gorgeous.
That's all everybody watches it
for. The cast had some big names at the time. Giovanna Ribisi, Delroy Lindo. You had a young Timothy Oliphant. I forget how to pronounce his name. Along with Angelina Jolie, who was barely in the movie, who looked a hot mess in that film. I'm not a fan of her. I don't think she looks all that great. Yes, I know all of our listeners are going to think I'm crazy and they're going to start pulling their hair, thinking I'm bonkers. I don't think Angelina Jolie is that pretty. Sorry. And the reason why is a movie called Gia. If you haven't seen Gia, you need to be a grown folk to watch Gia. There's a whole lot of nakedness in it. But Angelina looked fabulous in Gia. And she ain't looked that good since. Sorry, I like Gia, Angelina Jolie, and any other version I ain't into.
I stopped really liking her after Tomb Raider. I think that was a hot mess. Started going downhill for me.
Yeah. But she was barely in Gone in 60 Seconds, and she looked a hot mess.
The platinum braids.
Oh, that was terrible. Yeah, the platinum dread thing, that was not working. It was okay as a remake. Compared to the original, and I honestly, until you mentioned it, I forgot it was a remake.
That goes to show it stood the test of time. I Am Legend.
Okay, I'll give you that. Definitely better than the original. I'm always biased with Will Smith films because I'm such a huge Will Smith fan. I know the general masses are not the greatest fans of I Am Legend. To that, I can say suck it. I thought I Am Legend was a lot better than most people give it credit for. Was it a perfect film? Absolutely not. But I definitely think it's better than people give it its due for. It definitely better than the original. I think that you can definitely count that as a successful remake.
Yeah, I mean, I bought it twice, so.
Okay, there you go. There you go.
It wasn't intentional, but just the fact that I forgot that I had it and I bought it again shows you how much I liked it.
No doubt. All right, let's switch to the small screen. Television show remake. Give me one that was resoundingly successful for you.
Oh, now you put me on the spot. I don't know that many television remakes. Or maybe I probably know them, but I don't
even recognize. All right, well, I'll let you think about it. I'll give you mine. And I'm, I'm a big sci-fi geek. As a third generation Trekkie. For me, Battlestar Galactica. That was I wasn't expecting a whole lot when I heard sci-fi was gonna do a miniseries for it to test if people wanted to watch it. I watched the miniseries, but when the show was actually airing, money was not good, so we actually cut cable, so I didn't get to watch it while it was on air. I didn't actually get to watch it till years later when it was on Netflix, and I got to actually see what happened, because I watched a miniseries, but when the series came out, I didn't get to see it. So when I finally got Netflix and I watched the entire series, the show had been off for like maybe 2 or 3 weeks. Like, it was just finished its run, and only like the first season when it was on Netflix, and I was blown away. I was a big fan of the original Battlestar. I wasn't a big fan of Battlestar 1980, right. But I was a big fan of the original, and I thought it was amazing. I was very unsure about Starbuck as a woman. Hats off, claps to Katie Sackhoff for killing that. I'm sure she's heard it time and time again. But Katie, you killed it. Edward James Olmos. I mean, how many phenomenal roles has that dude done? Oh, I mean, yeah. Admiral Adama to Stand By Me. What's the math movie he did with what's his name? With Lou Diamond Phillips. I forget that movie, but that math movie he did that was amazing. I forget the name of the movie. That's terrible. That's really terrible to me. But, I mean, from his work on Miami Vice, Edward James Olmos is just, he's an amazing actor. And then the actors I hadn't even heard of on that show, like Jamie Bamber and the guy who played Hilo, I can't pronounce his real name. That name is crazy. It's I'm not even gonna. I'm sorry, dude. I'm not gonna butcher your name. I got too much respect for you to do that. I love watching. And my girl Trisha Heffler. I'm like, whoo, Trisha, holla. My wife knows that I love you. She was amazing at Six. And I love watching shows now where I see Battlestar alums. Like, I'll watch something, and I'm like, yep, Battlestar. It's a great show. Like, it's not Star Trek level now, but it was an amazing remake. I thought they vastly improved the Cylon storyline. It was amazing. I mean, truly better than the original. And the fact that they respected the original, that they had Richard Hatch, who played the original Apollo, on the show, was fantastic. Paying respect to the original while just producing a fantastic series. My hat's off to sci-fi. I love the miniseries that they did a couple years ago with Adama, on Adama's backstory a bit. Blood and Chrome, was a little disappointed that did become a show. But, sci-fi, Battlestar Galactica team, you know, Mary O'Donnell, all them. Best remake TV show I've ever seen.
Whoa. This one I think that's better.
Oh, okay. Don't say Knight Rider.
Doctor Who.
Okay, see, see, that's not a remake. Well, that's not a remake. That's a continuation. That's a continuation. That's not a remake. That's a continuation. If it was a remake, I'd give you that one. But it's a continuation. That's not a remake.
Yes. Well, I don't know.
That's not a remake.
It is a continuation, but it's not.
They took a break. It's been the show. Been,
they
you know,
took
the,
a long break.
It's been, yeah. Well, the thing's 50 years old. I mean, they took a long break. You know, they had that movie in the 90s. You know, they took a long break, but it was a break. They took a break. And technically, yes, I know we recounted season one with the Ninth Doctor, but to me, I really don't view it as a separate show or as a remake.
I mean, I don't. But at the same time, when you hear people talk about it, they talk about it as a remake.
See, I don't get that. I really don't get that. Like I hear people refer to classic Who, and then you know the and then current and modern Who,
right.
But I don't.
It's like a remake. You know what I mean?
But
like,
but see, but when I talk to people about it, they even though they separate the eras of it, they don't separate. To me, when they talk about it, they talk about it the way people talk about Star Trek movies, the way they talk about the series compared to the movies, because the series got in the 60s, the first movie didn't come out till 79. So like it's, you know, you had a long time between there. But it's all still one story. It's the same story, it's just later. And that's the way when I hear people talk about it, and I talk to people about it, that's how they talk about it. It's a different era, but it's still the same story, and it's still the same thing. Even though technicality-wise, I guess you could say it's a redo, but to me, a redo starts all over from the beginning, and clearly we know Who has not started over from the
right.
beginning.
Yeah,
you know,
nine,
yeah, they start where they left off, which you know I wish man Chris Eccleston would have done more than one season as a Doctor. I think he shortchanged us fans and himself a little bit on there, but I understand not wanting to be typecast after playing such an iconic role, but I would have loved just to. I'm a big Chris Eccleston fan. I know everyone tends to ride the coattails of David Tennant, and understandably so.
I'm a Matt Smith fan myself.
You see, you know, it's funny. Most guys really tend, I think you know what, like we as men like Matt Smith so much? Because he's ugly. That dude is ugly.
I just thought of the new era of Doctors. I thought he was the funniest.
Oh, he was very funny, but that dude is just
quirky.
Yeah, he was definitely funny and very quirky, but he's also an ugly dude. And David Tennant was such a pretty boy, and all you know, wouldn't always fall in. It kind of like took away from the who-ness, like, and Tennant had his own quirks. I loved all the machines. They go ding and ting and stuff. I thought that was great. One thing I appreciate about Matt Smith, I don't know if you've noticed this. When he started the role, he was playing Tennant. And then after the first couple episodes, he started to play himself. You know, play the new level. Apply the previous version. Yes. That thought that was amazing.
Yeah.
And he's undervalued from
now,
a lot.
I like them because he went against everything that was Doctor Who. You know, he got rid of the tie and went for the bow tie and the fez.
Oh.
To keep pulling out.
The fez was great. The fez was great. The cowboy hat was annoying. Because it was like the pushing America on it, and I thought I was not a big fan of the Stetson, but yeah, the fez was hilarious. That was great, and I liked the bow tie. I always thought that was great for what Moffat was doing as far as pushing the traditional Doctor Who boundaries, but still obviously respecting it. I thought Matt Smith was great. I thought it was great to not have a pretty boy Doctor Who. After the Tennant's run, because I think if Doctor Who looks too good, it takes away a bit from, you know, from the character. You know, I think the character suffered a little bit as Tenet got more and more popular, and you know, fans started paying a little too much more attention to his looks than the episodes, because Tenet's run was amazing. I mean, Blink to me is like the best episode of the current version, you know. But Smith had great versions episodes, and I'm really good with how Peter Capaldi is doing. I'm really enjoying his time as a doctor, and I'm even though I'm not excited that you know, that Danny Pink died, I'm not happy about that. I kind of wish that Clara would have gotten her man. I know it's, you know, after having Rory and Amy end up together in the past, you know, they kind of had to have some more heartbreak in there. But, you know, just let the brother get a girl. Let him get his girl, man. Like, you know. But I guess they gave Mickey Martha, so.
Yeah.
Which, going off the rails, I'm sorry, but I have to. Seeing that we're talking Who. Why is there not a Smith and Jones spinoff? I would love to see Smith and Jones, the spinoff, them hunting, you know, there being, alien hunters or whatever for hire. That would be a fantastic show. We already had the Sarah Jane Chronicles, which I enjoyed. I forget her name, the actress, but rest in peace. Torchwood had a pretty okay run. I don't want them to do another version, especially after the way the last one ended. And sorry, Mekhi Phifer, I just don't want to see you on TV. Stick to films, brother.
Not in anything related anyway.
Yeah, stick to films, brother. He did not have great chemistry with the Torchwood team, especially as decimated as it was. They're the only ones who kind of have this question mark on what happened after, you know, behind the scenes. And I think them as a couple would be a very intriguing show. And I think it would be great to have some of those previous companions just have at least a small appearance, because I'm really sick of, and I love Strax, he's funny, but I'm sick of Strax, Jenny, and the lizard chick whose name I always forget. Faster or whatever her name is. I'm really tired of them. I like them, but I'm really, really tired of them. Because we've had them pretty much since Smith and now Capaldi, and it's been a long time. Like, either give me a tease of some other of the Doctor's friends, or give me some new Doctor's friends, because these ones have really run their course.
Yeah.
You know? Like, I hate to say it, because I liked them and I liked their characters, but I just think they have, I don't see them adding much more to the show anymore.
I think they're trying to get through this Impossible Girl run, focusing more on Clara.
Well, see, the thing is, like, the Impossible Girl part's been figured out, so for me, like, I love Jenna Louise Coleman, mind you, but it's starting to feel a little stale with her now, because we solved it. We know what's happened. So, like, you know, and we know why she's an impossible girl, and that part isn't a part at all with Capaldi. So I'm like, what? Like, I don't know. I'm just intrigued as far as what, what's keeping her there. As, you know, we know with Danny gone, she has no reason to leave. So it's just, how long is she going to be the companion, and can we keep that relationship interesting for how long? Because we've seen the companion fall in love with the Doctor too many times. Honestly, you know, that ship ran its course with Sienna Smith, because she's not going to fall in love with this old dude.
Right.
I don't even know where else it could go with it. I'm excited, don't get me wrong. I'm extremely excited for, what is it, September 19th, I think?
Yes. Can't wait.
Yes, I'm extremely excited, but I'm also like, I have a little trepidation about the role of Maisie Williams. I applaud Moffat for getting some Game of Thrones talent to keep heat on the show. Very smart move. But, I'm a little skeptical on how that's going to impact, because, honestly, I wouldn't have picked Maisie Williams just because she looks too much like Jean-Louise Coleman, another short, short brunette. Yeah, I mean, you could have gone, there's a whole lot of women on this show, you could have gone after, I don't know if she's supposed to play a young kid or whatever, but she's looked too much like her, to me, but I may be just nitpicking like I like to do. But lastly, let's jump into the last thing of successful remakes, and I'm going to give you mine for video game, and I mentioned earlier, and that's the Resident Evil GameCube release. I'm not going to talk a whole lot more about it because I spouted off earlier how much I loved it. I can't think of a better game that's been remade beautifully from start to finish. I've never seen it. Obviously I reserve the right to change my mind in the near future with Final Fantasy VII, but I haven't seen a better remake of a video game, period, up until this time.
Yeah. Let me see. For me, I got so many, man. I don't even know where to start. There's so many so many remakes. Video games, they do a great job. Video game developers, I should say, have been doing a great job of remakes in general. There's very few that I could say were terrible.
Yeah, I can feel on that.
Obviously, I'm looking forward to Final Fantasy VII. That's probably the top of my list, even though it's not out yet.
Of course.
I don't know what my close second would be. This is so many.
Well, let me ask you this then. What game, aside from the ones we've talked about, would you like to see remade?
I would like to see... Me and my cousin talk this one all the time. Me and my cousin DJ. I would like to see Heavenly Sword remade and also a part two. And it's kind of like a cult classic.
Yeah, because I mean, Heavenly Sword, that's a PS3. That's a PS3 title. I mean, that's not that long ago. Now, I liked it, don't get me wrong.
Yeah, I mean, not many people played it. It eventually sold a million copies. It took a while.
Yeah, I think they did the rapper move and bought themselves platinum on Mantle. Yeah. You know? okay, I can see that.
If you want me to go back to PlayStation days.
I'm talking any game. I'm talking, you can go back far as the Pitfall on the Atari, bro.
Go all the way back. Let me think about it. I would like to see, there's a few Genesis games I'd like to see remade. Mortal Kombat, came back. That was pretty good. The one on PS4 is not bad. I mean, it's not really a remake. It's Mortal Kombat 10, but you might as well say it's a remake. They revamped all the characters and everything, and put some classic outfits and all that.
True that.
They brought back the fatalities the way we know them and love them.
That was important, yes. I'm not a big MK fan, but it's not MK without fatalities, man. It's not.
So, I thought that was a great remake / continuation to the series.
Oh, yeah. Well, how about this? Chew on this then. If we're talking platforms especially, I would like to see, from Nintendo side, a next gen of Mega Man. For Sega, which would be either on PS4 or the Xbox or both, I would like to see a remake next gen of Streets of Rage.
I was just gonna say that.
I think that has tremendous potential for a remake. And that was such an enjoyable game, and I think that I think with a controlled 3D experience, you could do a whole lot, and especially because that's a collaborative game.
I like to see too.
Don't say Echo the Dolphin.
No. That was an awesome game though for its time. don't think it could be made better. Not that it was great, but I just don't think you can make it better. I think it was a niche, and it did what it did, and that was it. But I like to see a successful NBA Jam remake. They did one, but it was kind of cheesy and weird. Big heads and all that. It was kind of funny looking.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. NBA Jam remake. That is. That's a tough one. Wow. Yeah. I remember the big head. I didn't like the big. The big head mode came out in the third one, I think.
Yeah. No. I mean, it was one that they recently did. It was on. I think it was on mobile.
The iOS version?
Yeah.
You know what? I bought that, and it's actually not bad, though.
It wasn't terrible. It just wasn't the NBA Jam that I know. You know?
It wasn't Tournament Edition, which really set, really just set the bar for that. Because once Tournament Edition came out, I ceased playing the first one.
Yeah. There was no other NBA Jam separate.
Yeah, and when I go back, I don't play the first one. I only play TE. You know, I liked the iOS version. I would like to see that on a console. And they did keep to the privacy, you know, they did the, it's not like 2K. I mean, they did it to side, you know, side scrolling still back and forth. I don't know if they would do it just because it's so simple. You really can't do with the engines that they have for, you know, for sports games right now. They're so complex where that's such a simple game that I don't see why they would redo it just because it's so simple. They don't have to do anything. All they'd have to really do is just give us the classic, you know, the classic power-ups and the classic characters. So, like, you know, the Will Smith, DJ, you know, Jazzy Jeff from the 90s, the Phoenix Gorilla, and then throw in some new people. Some people I probably wouldn't want to see, but they'd have to put Drake in there since he's, you know, works for the Raptors, for goodness sake, and Wale, since he works for the Wizards, they have him in there. And you'd have some of the cats that are, you know, big basketball fans, that they, you know, see if they could get their likeness in there, maybe like a Denzel. So, you know, and probably have a mode where you had retired players that could come in, you know, so you can get Shaq in there, and you can get, you know, and also maybe you could get Mike, because Mike has never been in an NBA Jam game. Right. So maybe you could get Mike on there and, you know, play with some of the older players, or just have, like, you know, just add, you know, so you have, like with TE, you had the rookies, and then when you beat, you know, when you beat the game, and the rookies went on to the teams that they got drafted by.
Yeah.
So the same thing, like, you beat the first time. I mean, maybe you beat it the first time, you get the rookies. You beat it the second time, you are at a harder level. You get legends, and the legends go to their respective teams. And you probably have, like, you know, 90s Shaq on Orlando and 2000s Shaq, you know, on the Lakers or whatever. You can, like, select, you know, if he goes to the Lakers, the Heat or whatever. And you have that version of them. And you have, you know, some classic players from, you know, from before. I think with especially with sports games, it's always, especially basketball games, it's always important to have the legends in there, to keep it interesting. Because you can only do so much, you know, with the limited P that you have. Because, I'm sorry, I mean, you know, if you're using the Clippers, you're only trying to use CP3, Blake, and DeAndre. You ain't trying to use, you know, J.J. Redick.
Yeah.
You know? So there's always so many people, so you want to have a little more selection. You got to go with some of these classic players. Not that the Clippers have a lot of classic players to deal with, because their great classic players consist of, like, Reggie Theus and, you know, Brent Barry.
Well, that was the thing that made NBA Jam so interesting anyway, was because it was mostly just the superstars, with obviously minus Mike, but, you know, it was, what was it, 3-on-3?
No, 2-on-2.
2-on-2.
Yeah, 2-on-2, and then you had the third, so.
There's plenty of new age superstars since the last NBA Jam that you can definitely get thrown in there.
Oh, yeah.
and still make it a fun game and interesting.
That's something, if they did it, and it was...
I just want to see what updated graphics, really. That's all I
Well, see, that's the thing, though. If they did update... And I don't think they could do updated graphics because of how they'd have to make a new game engine for it to have updated graphics, really. Yeah. Like, and then also, it wouldn't be NBA Jam without the pixelness and the, yeah, like... The
flying 50...
Yeah, like, if it... I don't know if it'd be the same if it was outside of 16-bit, to be honest. And if we went to 64-bit, it would be kind of blocky because of how 64-bit games kind of got like that when it comes to that style. Like, I don't know if it would feel the same, you know?
Then another... these would probably be my last two.
Okay.
I'd like to see Road Rash.
Oh, I love Road Rash.
Road Rash is amazing. Yeah. And you know me, I ride motorcycles. You know how much I love my motorcycles.
Oh,
so.
Yeah.
Road Rash is just right up my alley.
Great title.
Even when I was, you know, yay high.
Well, that's a great title. I 100% agree with you. I would totally dig a Road Rash remake as well as a, what's the Nintendo version, Nintendo game, the racing game that they show with the Power Glove on the Wiz. The Rad Racer?
Ridge Racer was PlayStation.
No, Rad Racer.
Rad Racer, yeah.
I think that was it. Something like that, but like, that was another really good title.
And then my last one, which everybody probably wasn't crazy about it, but Bloody Roar.
Oh, man, I forgot about Bloody Roar. Yeah, you have a really, really tough time convincing somebody to make a new Bloody Roar. I was shocked that they actually made... The new Killer Instinct, Bloody Roar. That was not well received by everyone. That was a tough sell.
It was just cool being able to like you change back and forth into the animal and
all no, that stuff. I understand why. I mean, I dug that part too. I just most people I know just didn't like it. And it didn't play all that well.
It had some bugs.
Yeah. It definitely wasn't the easiest to play. Fantastic concept, but without a doubt. If you would remake something, that probably would be a significant upgrade to the original. But I don't know. I don't know if it would have enough traction to be worth making there.
Interesting concept, though.
No, you know, really great concept. Probably just, you know, like, you know, execution, man. You know how that is. Sometimes these guys, they don't execute as they need to. Oh, well, let's close out the pod with this last one. Let me ask you this: how did you feel about the reboot of in my feelings are as is the greatest first person shooter of all time in GoldenEye.
I don't know. I like it, but I don't know because I was so used to, you know, back PlayStation days, all your friends come over, you get the multi tap out,
yes.
Everybody hook up the four controllers, or if you got the N64, everybody plug in.
Yep.
And that's what made it fun. I don't know, having it online, if you get that same experience, you know.
You don't. I can tell you, game developers, if you're listening to this, please, I understand y'all want money. We want money for you too. You keep getting our money, but please do us all a favor. Multiplayer is not as fun if you can't have four people playing. Now, remember, people, in the 90s, the max, like, people TV size we had was like a 24-inch TV, all right? And we have four heads playing GoldenEye on a 24-inch TV, and it was a blast. 14-inch TV. Yeah, or a 14-inch TV. Now, going back, and again, Pastor George, if you ever hear this, I'm sorry. But when I was working at Camp Dry Gulch, one thing, we had the chapel was also a TV studio for a show that was called Kids in the Move. It was a Bible Kids game show, and they had one screen on each side, and they would use it for video clues. And again, when the campers weren't there on the weekend, at night we would go into the chapel and we would hook up the N64 and play GoldenEye on these massive screens, which was freaking fantastic. But most of the time, you're playing on a 24-inch or smaller screen. Now, you can get a 60-inch TV nowadays for less than $1,000. But why do I have to have my homie be in his room with his TV and his system, and my other homie be across town with his TV and his system? We ain't got that type of juice, y'all. We don't have it. Look at the economy. Make me a shooting game, please. And props to Rainbow Six, Vegas 1 and 2, I think, for at least having two people be able to play the game at the same time and cooperate. I would like four. I would like to take my 60-inch TV and divide it into four parts so me and my homies can all play at the same time. And all we have to do is bring our DualShock controllers, pair up, and we can rock out. That is where fun is. Fun with those games is right there. I'm sorry, Call of Duty is a great game, but I do not enjoy just being by myself all the time with playing Call of Duty. I'm sorry, because if I get a great kill and I'm working with somebody, I'd rather turn and high five that dude than be like on my headset, be like, "Yo, good shot, son." I'm sorry, I like to do a chest bump, I like to celebrate, I like to talk trash a little bit if we're playing against each other. That's part of the fun. Part of the fun is throwing your controller at your homie when he just sniped you again because you're frustrated. You know what I'm saying? So game developers who make first-person shooters and multiplayer shooters, please, multiplayer does not exclusively mean online. Please make one where we can have our homies be there and play together. Gaming should be a communal thing, y'all. You know?
Of course.
Communal thing. That's going to be my the final rant for the show. I'm rocking Mr. Magic. He's UniqDNA. Thank you for joining us, y'all. We'll see you on the flip side. Lord, this for you.